In this video, I'm going to go over the basic organization of a cache, and this could be either your L1 cache, L2 cache, L3, any kind of cache. Okay, and you know, to keep this example manageable, I'm going to assume that this is a very small cache that only contains 64 bytes of data, right? You know, even the basic L1 cache could have at least 8 kilobytes or 32 kilobytes of data. So this is a really small cache. I'm also going to assume that the minimum granularity of keeping something in the cache is going to be an 8-byte word. Okay, so many architectures today are 64-bit architectures, which means each register can save 64 bits. So a load could be bringing in 64 bits from memory and putting it into a register. Okay, so I'm going to assume that the cache stores data at the minimum size of 64 bits, which is an 8-byte word. So you know, since this is only a 64-byte cache, I can only store 8-byte words, and that's what I'm showing in this example. There are 8 different 8-byte words being saved in what is called the data array. So now when I issue a load which says, you know, bring something into R1 from an address, that address is what I'm showing in this gray box over here, and it could be, let's say, a 40-bit address. The last 3 bits in this address specify exactly which byte I'm referring to in this 8-byte word. Okay, so based on the address, you know, maybe I'm fetching this block over here, but when I bring in the block, it's actually 8 different bytes that I'm bringing in. If I'm not dealing with a 64-bit entity, if I'm, let's say, dealing with characters where every character is represented by 1 byte, then I might actually want to specify, you know, 1 byte out of those 8 bytes. Okay, and it is these last 3 bits which allow me to do that. Okay, so if those last 3 bits were, say, 011, then I'm referring to, you know, byte number 3 over here inside this 8-byte word. Okay, so instead, if I was bringing in 16-byte words, then I would need 4 bits to specify, you know, which specific byte I'm referring to among those 16 bytes. Okay, so those last 3 bits in my address are referred to as the offset bits. Then, you know, since there are 8 different entries over here, I need to pick out one of these 8 entries, and that's where my data is going to be saved. Okay, so to pick out, you know, 1 out of 8 entries, I need a 3-bit index. Okay, so this is 101 over here. So in this case, this given address had 101 in those 3 index bit positions. So it goes down to this element number 5. Okay, starting at element number 0, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Right? So I'm referring to element number 5 in my cache, and that's where the data is going to be saved. So I go down, so if I'm looking for this address, I will go down to element number 5 in my cache, and hopefully that has the data that I'm interested in, right? So that'll have a 64-bit sequence, which is perhaps the one that I'm referring to. Okay, but of course there are several different addresses which will have 101 in those 3-bit in that 3-bit field. Okay, so you know, in this case, maybe I'm looking for address A, B, C, D, 101000, but there could be other addresses too. Let's say A, B, C, C, 101000, which also has the same 3 bits over here and maps to the same entry. Okay, so to distinguish between different elements that might be mapped to the same location in my cache, I need something called a tag array. Okay, so this tag array, for example, might have kept track of the fact that what is stored over here is ABCD 10100. So if this is what I'm looking for, I'm going to simultaneously look up the data array and the tag array. Okay, so I'll look at these 3 index bits. It says I'm looking at entry number 5. So go down to entry number 5 that has a 64-bit sequence. Likewise, go down to the same entry number 5, and that will tell you what is the tag, or you know, what is the entire address for the data that has been saved in entry number 5. Okay, so I'll do a comparison to see, well, you know, looks like ABCD has been stored. I'm looking for ABCD. There's a match. So the data that has been stored in this data array is exactly the data that I'm looking for. Okay, instead, if I had been looking for data ABCC 101000, I would use 101 to look up, you know, this entry. I would do a comparison of ABCD and ABCC, and I would discover that what is stored in the cache is not what I'm looking for. So that would be a cache miss. Okay, so then I get the data that I'm really interested in. Maybe I get it in L2 or L3, bring that data in, put the data over here, and then I fix the tag to say now what has been stored in the cache is location ABCC 101000. Okay, so the tag array helps me keep track of, you know, what are the few elements that have been kept in the cache, and I use the index bits to pick out the particular entry, and I use the tag bits to discriminate between these different blocks. Okay, so any address is broken up into these three different fields. I said that I'm assuming a 40-bit address. So, you know, 3 bits are used for offset. And this is because I'm having an 8-byte word in every single row. Okay, then I have 3 index bits because I have, you know, 8 different rows of data. And each row is also called a set. Okay, so because I have 8 rows of data or 8 sets, I need 3 index bits. So the remaining 34 bits are my tag bits. And that is what I need to specify the rest of the address so I can distinguish between different addresses that map to the same set in my cache. Okay, I should also mention that this is called a direct mapped cache because every address is mapped to a unique cache location, right? So given an address, let's say ABCC101000, by looking at these 3 bits, I'm picking out one unique location in my cache. That's the only place that this given data element could be saved in. Okay, and hence it's called a direct mapped cache. Okay, now let me expand on the structure a little bit more. Let's extend it some more. Okay, so I'm not happy with just storing eight byte words because I know that programs exhibit spatial locality. Okay, so if I'm touching element X, I'm expected to touch X plus 1, X plus 2, and so on in the near future. Okay, so when I bring stuff into my cache, it doesn't make sense to just bring in 8 bytes. What I want to do is bring in, you know, more data, say 32 bytes or 64 bytes. And if I bring in so much data together, and you know, these are sequential blocks that I'm bringing in, if I bring all this data in together, then when I move on to X plus 1 and X plus 2 and so on, I will end up finding them in cache. Okay, so usually each set of the cache is not just 8 bytes, it's usually a little bigger than that. So in this example, I have expanded, you know, instead of using this 8 bytes, I have a 32 byte field in each one of my sets. Okay, so my, you know, my set size or my block size or my line size, and you know, all these terms mean the same thing, is now 32 bytes. Since I've grown my block size, I will need more offset bits, right? So to pick out a specific byte within this 32 byte field, I will need 5 offset bits. Okay, so my address organization will change. I need 5 bits for offset, I need 5 bits for offset, 3 bits for index, and the remaining 32 bits are used for the tag. Okay, now, you know, as I said, this is a direct map structure. There are multiple different addresses mapping to the same location. So, you know, if my program happens to frequently alternate between ABCD101 something and ABCC101 something, both of these, since they have the same index bits, will map to the same location over here. Right? So at a given point of time, only one of those two will be found. And so if my program keeps alternating between these two, it brings in one, throws out the other one, and so you keep having cache misses. Okay, so to avoid these problems from, you know, these pathological cases where you have an unusual amount of conflicts for the same entry, you end up increasing the number of elements stored in every single set. Okay, and that's called a set associative cache. So what I'm showing over here is a two-way set associative cache, where with every single set, I'm associating 2 different blocks of data, or, you know, 2 different ways of data. So I look at 101, it goes down over here and says, well, your block could either be found in way 1 or it could be found in way 2. And the contents of way 1 are stored over here, so the tag could be ABCC. Tag over here could be ABCD. Right? So if you're alternating between these two elements, ABCC101 something and ABCD101 something, both of those blocks of data are being stored in cache. Okay, so when I read those things out of the data array, I also read both of these elements out of my tag array. I compare them with the data that is currently being looked up. So if I'm looking for ABCD101 whatever, I do a comparison and it tells me that way 2 does have the data I'm looking for, right? So, you know, both of these are read out, and then from here the data from way 2 is then finally sent back to the processor. Okay, so this is how you would organize your cache to minimize conflicts for the same entry, and this is how you would increase your hit rate. Okay, so this is known as a set associative cache, and you can do, you know, 2-way set associative, 3-way, 4-way, as much as you want. Okay, so this is how a basic cache is organized, and I'll go through a realistic example so people understand the sizes of the index bits, offset bits, and so on. Okay, so I have a 32 kilobyte cache. It's four-way set associative, and each block has a size of 32 bytes. Okay, so here's one 32 byte block. There are four of them in one set, right? So one set has four ways. Each way has a size of 32 bytes. Okay, so when the processor makes a request, I'm going to return these 32 bytes. Okay, so to pick out one byte out of these 32 bytes, you need five offset bits. Okay, and then the next set of bits are going to be your index bits, and this is determined by how many sets you have, and then the rest is just tag. Okay, so let's see how many index bits you would need, right? So one set has four 32 byte blocks, so it has 128 bytes. The total cache is 32 kilobytes, so the number of sets would be 32 kilobytes divided by 128 bytes, which is 256. Okay, so there are 256 sets. Okay, and so you would need 8 bits of index, and then if you assume that the address itself is a 40 bit address, then the rest of it is tag, so 27 bits of tag. Okay, so the number of sets is 256, index that corresponds to 8 index bits, 5 offset bits because of the 32 byte block size, and then the rest is 27. Rest of the 40-bit address is are your tag bits. So now there's also a question about how large is my tag array, right? So corresponding to every block I store in my data array, so this is my data array, and correspondingly I have the structure which is my tag array as well, which is going to mirror my data array. It's going to have four ways and it's going to have as many sets. Okay, so corresponding to every block I save in my data array, I need to save its tag over here. Right, and each tag is 27 bits. Okay, so 27 bits for each block. There are four ways in each set, and there are 256 sets. Okay, so this corresponds to 27 kilobits of data, or you know, that's roughly 3.375 kilobytes of data. Right, so it is much smaller than the data array, which stores 32 kilobytes of data. Okay, but it is non-trivial, so it has to be considered during the cache design.